So how many of you, when the gospel was being read, got a little uncomfortable? That's on true confessions. Everybody raise your hand if you feel a little uncomfortable. The gouging the eyes out thing and the chopping the hands off thing, let me just comfort you for a moment, is hyperbole. Okay, that means that Jesus takes it to a little extreme to make a point. I'm just wanting to make sure, because throughout Christian history, there have actually been people that have taken that literally. All right. Jesus didn't mean you to take it literally. Jesus meant you to focus on the importance of what he was trying to say by raising it up a level. Gouging your eyes out and cutting your hands out might be a little extreme. Do not do that. All right. But pay attention to what Jesus is talking about in the midst of the continued teachings of the Beatitude, which I just remind you, the Beatitudes are Jesus' essential teachings. So he sat down on the mount with a group of those who were following him, and he laid out for them what it meant to be a disciple, a follower of the living God, the God in flesh, Jesus. Praise be to God. But those sayings make me a little uncomfortable too. People kind of go in different directions. I mean, what about divorce? What if I've been divorced? What if I've committed adultery? I hope nobody murdered anybody. Okay, don't raise a hand. Okay, I don't need to know right at the moment, right? But these teachings, man, they're some hard teachings, and they can create some confusion. But I think it's important for us to actually approach them and break them down and figure out what is being shared with us today. So important in that text is that Jesus begins those statements by saying, "You have heard before." And then he goes on to say, But I say to you. You have heard it before, thou shalt not commit murder, but I say to you, you've heard, do not commit adultery, but I say to you. And he keeps on going with that. It's evident that the gospel writer Matthew is approaching a predominantly Jewish audience. He is. He's writing to those who are from the Jewish community. As a matter of fact, Jesus, when he's teaching on the Mount, is teaching a Jewish audience. So when he says, you have heard it before, they probably had heard it before because they knew the law. But I say to you. So what is Jesus doing in the midst of that? What is Matthew's point in sharing the story of the Sermon on the Mount for us? He's moving us beyond the law, right? He's clarifying. In other words, it's not just about a bunch of rules. It's not just about getting the rules right. It's not about getting all the boxes checked. There's something deeper going on in what God desires for us, and God desires us to be in relationship with each other, right? And in the midst of that relationality, God wants us to focus on the heart more than the law. As a matter of fact, Jesus says, you have heard it said before. That's what the law says. But I say to you, you need to take it a step further. There's something else going on here. There's a much deeper conversation needed than just don't do this. Right? Got up your game. Matthew's also making the point that Jesus stands above the law itself. We participate in this practice at Cornerstone, by the way. When we get to the gospel reading, I stole this from the Catholic and the Anglican Church. I don't think that I created it. Never mind. I started this myself as a practice to remind us when we hear the gospel that the gospel comes right into the midst of us. So we walk the gospel into the midst of the community. It reminds us, first and foremost, that God did not stay out there in the heavens somewhere, that the Word of God, the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ shouldn't be just read from the pulpit, but actually the gospel resides right in our midst. Amen? And to totally steal again from Eugene Peterson's translation of the Gospel of John, chapter 1, he says that Jesus moves right into the neighborhood. So the gospel comes right into the midst of us. We're surrounding it. We're breathing it in. It's a part of us. God doesn't stay out there. God comes and exists right with us in flesh. Praise be to God. Amen. But it also pays tribute to this. We don't worship the book. Do y'all know that? We worship Jesus. Which reminds me of another great quote by Martin Luther. The gospel is the cradle that carries the Christ. It's not the Christ in and of itself. In other words, the book, the Bible, well, it's an important means of revelation, but it in and of itself is not what we worship. Jesus stands above the Bible itself. Amen? Jesus stands above the law. Everything is held accountable to who Jesus is. His life, his teaching, his death, and his resurrection. That's the story we embrace. That's the story that trumps everything else. So it exists right here in the midst of us. And we pay tribute and we give testimony that the word is read, the good news story of Jesus Christ is read, because Jesus is above the law. So you have heard it said, but I say to you, Jesus is saying, law is great, but let's take it a little deeper. Let's remove it just from words on the page and let's apply it to our hearts. And if you go through each and every one of those proclamations, you realize that what Jesus is doing is he's inviting us into the depths of the relationship of the folks he's speaking about. Matter of fact, most commentators I read this past week, when they're talking about the Beatitudes, reference this kind of phrase. It's actually the sermon title, is that what Jesus is reminding us is that we are in the business of valuing others and protecting them from the brokenness and the dysfunction of the world. In other words, Jesus is about bringing together unity, celebrating the diversity of God's people. Jesus is not about separation, not about us versus them. Jesus is about reminding us that we are all human beings, all created in the image of God. Each and every one of us have sacred value and worth. This is the tough one. Take a deep breath. Even our enemies. You've heard it said before, but I say to you, let's just take the divorce comment, okay? Because I've had a million people come up to me, Pastor, I'm divorced. I said, along with 65% of the world, right? Right? And they get so focused on the issue of divorce that they missed the point. Who's Jesus talking about or talking to? He's talking to the men who are gathered there, who've been given permission by the law to simply give their wives a certificate of divorce if they don't like them anymore. Okay, you follow? Are you tracking with me? You have heard it said before, but I say to you, what Jesus does in that moment is he elevates women. He tells them, you've had the easy way out long enough, men. But women are human beings created in the image of God, too. You've heard it said before, but I say to you, unless you value the person standing in front of you, realize that they are a human being and desire to protect them within the love of God, then you don't get it. You've heard it said before, but I say to you, there's a depth, right, in this journey. This relationship that we have with God and this relationship that we have with each other can be beautiful, amen, and it can be messy. It's one of the great proclamations here at Cornerstone. We are a beautifully messy church. Anybody beautiful out there? You all should raise your hands. You are beautiful. And simultaneously, anybody else out there messy? Yeah. We're all in the same vessel, beautifully messy, right? Beautifully messy, praise be to God. And we're called to enter into the relationships, to value one another, and to do the challenging works of entering into the depths of what those relationships mean and how we're supposed to live them out in the world. A good example of that is taking a simple concept that we tend to claim as a rule or a law, and then breaking it down. And the best example I have, I think, in its simplest form, other than Dominique's beautiful children's sermon about anger, is that whenever I have a confirmation class come through Cornerstone, I always talk about cussing. Do not use the Lord's name in vain, and somehow that gets translated to do not cuss. All right? And so I ask people, why is cussing a sin? Because my mom told me it was a sin. And when I said that word, I got my mouth washed out with soap. Anybody have their mouth washed out with soap in their lifetime? Yeah. Did you cuss again? Oh, there we go. You lawbreakers. Right? But you miss the point if it's just about the rule. The problem most parents have is they don't take enough time to actually explain to their children why saying such words might be broken or dark or a problem. They just say, don't do that, and wash your mouth out with soap and send you to your room, and you're thinking, what did I do? Right? So when I go through confirmation class, I have all the confirmands sit there in a big whiteboard, and I say, I want you to write down or tell me all the cuss words you know. We actually lost a family at Cornerstone because I did that, just so you know. But they missed the point too, okay? And the kids love it. And at first, they're a little hesitant, right? They'll say things kind of sheepishly under their breath. What did you say? And so eventually, they kind of loosen up, and then they let go. And then all of a sudden, I learned some cuss words. And we write them all on the screen. And then I turn to them. I say, why are those words bad? Why are those words bad? Confirmation class. Because they hurt others. They're a sin because they cause harm. Words are cuss words when they do harm to other people, or they're violent words. And God calls us to be a people of peace and light. So when you hit your thumb with a hammer and you say, Sheol, that is not a cuss word. That's an act of pain. But if you turn your attention to your sibling with a heart of anger and you inflict words that cause harm, Jesus said, you have heard it said before, thou shalt not murder. But I say to you, my siblings, all our life's journey is to allow our hearts to align with Jesus's. He's inviting us into that through this teaching. And his teachings, they stand way above the law, because they're the way of life. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.